In talking about treating emphysema, I think the most important thing, the first thing to talk about, is to stop smoking. Out of all the therapies, this is the only one that will stop the disease from getting any worse. Since smoking can cause emphysema, it's like the first way to get out of the hole is to stop digging it any further, right? So stop smoking, that's the first one. Now, in terms of drug therapies, they can't reverse what's already been done, but it can help with the symptoms. And I think it's important to divide it between chronic therapies and acute. So chronic is what a patient would take every day to maintain their status. But acute is when once in a while emphysema can have exacerbations. They can get a whole lot sicker really quickly. And we use a different combination of drugs to get them through that acute disease. An important first class of drugs in the chronic maintenance therapy, I think, are the bronchodilators. So broncho, which refers to the airways, and dilator just refers to the fact that these drugs get your airways to open up like a tube that becomes bigger in diameter. So if this is our airway tree, like this, branching and branching off, if I take a cut right here so that we can look across this tube, it will look something like this. So you have the outside and you have the lumen, which just means the inside where the air goes through. And in here, in the walls of the airway, it's actually full of smooth muscle. So smooth muscle are not skeletal muscles. We can't control it with our mind. But a combination of things in the body, like the nervous system and other conditions, affect how tightly wound this muscle is. So smooth muscle. And the way that I've drawn it here is actually pretty tightly wound. So look at how small this lumen is becoming as the muscle tightens. And the muscles contract this way to squeeze down on that lumen. Now the bronchodilators can open up that airway. Now the lumen will draw it as this big because the muscles around it have relaxed a little bit. It's not so tightly wound anymore. And see how much room this gives us in the middle? That will allow a lot more air through than this little lumen back here. The bronchodilator is actually an umbrella term. It includes several classes of drugs, but all of them share the effect of opening up that airway. Now, the first class of bronchodilators I want to mention are the beta 2 agonists. So they stimulate the beta 2 receptors. Now, beta 2 receptors are part of the sympathetic nervous system. This is the fight or flight response. And as part of it, it wants to open up your lungs a little bit. So stimulating the beta 2 receptors will do just that. Now, one drug you might have heard of in this class would be albuterol. And actually, the drugs in this class all end with something R-O-L. That's an easy way to recognize them, just from the names that can make no sense in English. Now, the second class of drugs would be the anticholinergics, which are, they're antagonists, which means it turns off the receptor. This involves different receptors on the airways, but the effect is the same. In these drugs, their names often end in opium. And it has nothing to do with the drug opium, it's just a coincidence like that. Okay, so bronchodilators open up the airway, but one of the reasons that they're constricted in the first place is because there's too much inflammation. And the next class I want to talk about are the leukotriene inhibitors. Now again, what are these words? They mean nothing in English. Now leukotriene is an important player in the cascade that leads to inflammation. So for example, in the cascade, if we have A leading to B, leading to C, leading to D, and so on, eventually it leads to leukotrienes, which here I'll just write LT for leukotriene. So this is the goal of the inflammation cascade. We want to get here to cause inflammation, which includes restricting the airway and other things. So obviously by inhibiting leukotrienes, we tone down on the inflammation. So it gets rid of some of the mucus and the constriction in our lungs that we're fighting in the first place. Now, especially in emphysema, toning down the inflammation is a big deal because inflammation is how we get so much neutrophils and elastase. So toning down the inflammation by inhibiting some of the leukotriene helps the disease from getting worse as quickly. Now, a lot of emphysema patients can take these chronic medications every day. But unfortunately, sometimes they can still develop an exacerbation or a flare where the compensation system they have in place is not working all of a sudden and they get much sicker really quickly. So our goal here is short-term, get them back to their baseline. And one of the first things we give them are antibiotics. Antibiotics. Now, sometimes when they come to the hospital, they already have an infection. But if they don't, we still give them antibiotics for prophylaxis, which just means the disease hasn't happened yet. We're giving it to prevent it, prevention, just in case. Because when they're having an exacerbation, their ability to deal with infection goes down. As a general rule in the body, anytime you have blockage or things not moving the way they should, there can be infection behind it, because our body is constantly clearing things out of our system. So in emphysema, for example, if you have these dilated airways, these walls, and the air is trapped back here, in exacerbation, that gets even worse. So imagine all these collapsed airways. Now, all the things moving out are not working great in emphysema to begin with, and now they're even worse. So we have a dramatic increase in the possibility of having infections. So there's bacteria in the lungs all the time, and the lungs try to clear them. But now we're spinning out of control in this flare, and the usual system to clear these bacteria is not working well, so we give them antibiotics. Just because they have a pneumonia or some other infection on top of everything right now, that would be horrible. So we want to do everything we can to prevent that, so antibiotics. And the next thing, in terms of inflammation, we got to give them a huge dose of something. We got to pull out the big guns here. So we want to give them some steroids. Now, steroids are the universal tampering down the inflammation big guns. So if we have our cascade again, A leading to B, to C, to D, dot, 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 eventually to leukotrienes. Steroids work much earlier in the cascade. Let's say it works in step C. We usually give them a pretty big dose, and the cascade stops right here. Now that's good for preventing inflammation, but since this is a cascade and it's connected, so D is also not working. And all the other things that branch off of C and D, the other arms of the immune system, which inflammation is part of, are also not working. So with all these things out of commission, yes, our inflammation goes down. That's our goal. But at the same time, it also takes down the immune system. So they're immune compromised during their steroids treatment, so immune system down. This makes the antibiotics even more necessary. But also, this is why we try to not give people steroids for a long, long time. This is like an emergency save of our cars running down a hill. We need to stop it first, and then we can think about how to get back on track. So that's steroids. And another thing, so this person can't breathe, they're having trouble getting air in and out, they come to the hospital, it might seem kind of logical to put them on oxygen, right? In the hospital, we put oxygen on people at the drop of a hat anytime they have breathing problems. But I'm going to put a question mark here by oxygen, because this is actually kind of tricky in emphysema patients. To explain that, let's talk about the respiratory drive. Respiratory drive is a combination of mechanisms in the body that make you breathe. You notice that you don't have to think about breathing all day long. That's because between your brain and the nervous system, your lungs, there's a system in place to make you breathe. Now, usually, let's say you're supposed to have this much oxygen, this is O2, and you're only supposed to have this much carbon dioxide. So when you breathe, carbon dioxide is going out, and oxygen is what you want to take in. Now usually the body's very sensitive to these levels, exactly where each one is. And usually the brain is programmed in such a way that if our CO2 goes up, this is what stimulates us to breathe. So our respiratory center is more centered on having extra CO2. But now, emphysema is obstructive disease, right? So we always have too much CO2. And since that's chronic, the body is smart. It learns after a while that this patient is just going to have a little more CO2 than usual. Look at this new dotted line. That's our new normal. We also have a little bit less of oxygen because their lungs are so inflated, it's hard to take in more air. So this is our new O2, this is our new CO2. Now since our CO2 is always above that line stimulating us to breathe, the body's like, okay, I get it, I'm gonna change my signal. So in emphysema patients, the lack of oxygen here, this level, is actually what drives them to breathe. So the respiratory drive has shifted from CO2 driven to O2 driven. They need to constantly be reminded that they lack oxygen to breathe. Okay, so in our patient with an O2 heavy respiratory drive, if you give them oxygen, what happens? That oxygen goes up and we lose our respiratory drive. So ironically, giving them oxygen can decrease the drive to breathe. And that's the last thing you want in somebody who's having an emergency with breathing. Also, the body chemistry and pH, it's all used to having a little more CO2 than usual. So suddenly giving them oxygen can actually knock this system off balance. And so it has to be given with caution. If somebody's given oxygen, their breathing has to be monitored, making sure that they're still breathing. And really, if they really lose that respiratory drive, there are machines with masks that can take over that drive and make sure that people breathe. So this is a quick overview of some of the drugs that we use to treat emphysema, whether it be every day or acutely. But most of all, they have to stop smoking. If smoking is what caused their emphysema, stop now before it gets worse. And if they got emphysema through another way, then definitely stop smoking to reduce the number of flares they have and to lessen the burden on the lungs and to stop digging further in this hole.